بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. He begins it by saying that صيام شهر رمضان وجب في رجب شعبان صوم ندب, that it's an obligation to fast Ramadan. كتب عليكم الصيام كما كتب على الذين من قبلكم. The fasting was prescribed for you, it's an obligation, just as it was prescribed on people before you. So Jews and Christians have fasting. And the fasting of, he mentions Sha'ban and Rajab and Sha'ban, which are any days. The Prophet ﷺ fasted the 2 months that preceded Ramadan, and during that time, some of the Sahaba said that it seemed like he never broke his fast. So he definitely prepared for Ramadan with these 2 months. And then also he mentions that Ramadan is يثبت الشهر برؤية الهلال, that it's by sighting the moon that the month is established. So if you have, now we've got people here that are arguing that calculation should be used, and the problem with the calculations is, and one of their arguments is, well, we calculate the prayer times, so why can't we calculate Ramadan? And the problem with that argument, Imam al-Qarafi wrote a famous book. It's probably one of the most really original works in the history of Islamic jurisprudence. But he wrote a book called Furuq, which is all the subtle differences in things in the Islamic legal system. But one of the things, one of his Furuq, is the difference between calculating the prayer times and calculating Ramadan. So he actually brings this issue, 9th century scholar, and he says that that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we talked about sabab, right? Does everybody remember sabab? What's a sabab? Right, it's a reason, it's necessary but not necessarily sufficient, right? So you have necessary reasons and then sufficient reasons. So it's a necessary reason for the obligation of something, for instance. So sabab wujud al-dhuhr, the sabab, the cause for the obligation of dhuhr, is when the sun, according to Ibn Arafah, moves 1 degree from the 90th degree in the sky, 180 degree horizon. It gets to 90 degrees. If it moves to 91 degrees, which takes about 4 minutes, each degree takes 4 minutes, then that becomes a sabab. So he says that the sabab for the prayer times are positions of the sun. They're positions. Duruk al-shams, mail al-shams, ghasaq al-layl, you know, Quran al-fajri. The Quran specifically mentions points of position. The Duruk al-Shams is when the sun moves to that point. The Ghasaq al-Layl is a very specific time when Isha starts, the Fajr. So, إِذَا غَرَبَتْ الشَّمْسِ, if the sun goes down, then we pray. Now, however you determine whether the sun's gone down or not is irrelevant. As long as you know the sun has gone down, That's the thing. But with Ramadan, he put the sabab with the sighting. He didn't say, for instance, you know, when the moon separates from the sun, which is called mufaraqa. Now, the moon, and this is something a lot of people just, they don't understand, but it's a very important point to understand. The moon has phases, right? Now the moon, this is the sun, the earth, here we are. The moon has these phases, these are quarters, all right? So you've got four quarters. There's first quarter, second quarter, third quarter, fourth quarter. When the sun lines up with the moon, the sun comes between, right? Now, if you look at the earth, there's something called an ecliptic of the moon, all right? This is 5 degrees. That's the ecliptic. What that means is the moon does not go around the earth in a fixed plane. All right, it's a tilted plane of 5 degrees. So as it goes around, right, it's changing its position, which is why we get eclipses, because there's a point here when it hits that 0 degree, the equal plane, 2.5 degrees. When it hits that equal plane, if it hits it at one of these two points, either in a full moon or in a new moon, then it lines up perfectly with the sun. Got it? So when it comes in, if it's a full moon, the earth comes between the sun and the moon and blocks it out completely. Normally, it's 5 degrees. You see, it's in that ecliptic, and so you can see the full moon. But when it's in, it's outside the ecliptic, when it comes into the ecliptic, it disappears. And the way this has been designed is quite, I mean, it is stunning. There's no other word for it. Because it's done in perfect proportions so that the moon and the earth, each one of them matches up perfectly given the distance. Right? So this is like 92 million miles away. But because of the ratio, this is 250,000 miles away, right? But the ratio is that this appears perfectly equal to the sun. And the same is true of the earth when it goes into the ecliptic because of the way it's lined up with the moon. So they are signs. That's what the Prophet ﷺ said, you know, that the eclipses are signs for people who think, you know, what a coincidence. There's actually a book that was titled something like, "What a Coincidence." You know, like, astronomers recognize this thing is just very amazing. So what happens, this period, there is a period when the moon enters into an occultation. It's called the muhaq. All right. You have the Badr, right, and then you have the muhaq, and then you have the hilal, and then you have the rest of the time. It's called qamar. All right. So the muhaq is when it enters into this period of time. And it disappears. That's why يَمْحَقُ اللَّهُ الرِّبَى. God makes riba disappear. You know, the benefits of riba, He obliterates them. So يَمْحَقُ اللَّهُ الْقَمَرِ. You know, He makes it disappear. So that's called the muhaq. That can last up to 3 days where it just disappears. Nobody sees it. Because it's gone in to this where the sun is not giving us any reflection. So we can't see, because it's in this period here, you can't see the light of the sun on it. Now, during that point, there is a point where it lines up perfectly with the sun. If it's in the ecliptic, it disappears and you get a solar eclipse. So as the moon lines up with the sun, you get a solar eclipse. Or you get a partial solar eclipse if it's partially in the ecliptic. If it's completely in it, lined up perfectly, then the sun disappears. If it's not lined up perfectly, the sun, you'll see part of the sun. And the same with a partial lunar eclipse, same reason, because it's not fully in the ecliptic. The ecliptic is when the planes are perfectly lined up with the sun. All right, because we're lined with the sun. The moon is tilted on the ecliptic, which is 5 degrees. But during times of the year, it moves into that ecliptic, and then it's perfectly lined up, so you see it disappear. Now, what happens is that when the sun and the moon, here's the Earth, when the sun and the moon line up, they line up for the time that it takes, like a solar or lunar eclipse. It's, 20, 30 minutes as it comes in, and then they line up, and then it starts to move away. That point, when it starts to move away, and you begin to see the light of the sun on that portion as it's moving away, is called the mufaraqa. All right? We call it the angular separation in English. It's the angular separation of the moon and the sun. When you get the angular separation of the moon and the sun, you can look at this event. So with astronomy, you can determine the exact point where the moon is born. But that birth is an astronomical birth. All right? This is what's really important. You have to understand this. That birth is an astronomical birth. That is the new moon according to modern astronomy. Now, 2,500 years ago, the Greeks determined when that conjunction happens, the conjunction of the sun and the moon. They determined it to half a minute on average. They didn't have the precision because the moon is not following a regular course. It slows and it speeds up. It's relative. So at certain points it's faster, at certain points it's slower. What that does is it changes the amount of time it takes to go around the Earth. But the Greeks averaged it. And they averaged it so well that they could determine and predict eclipses. So they knew when the mufaraqa happened. All right? So this is ancient knowledge. Nothing has been improved on this except for the precision where you get the 0.0001. That's what's been improved. But the actual knowledge of this, they could determine it down to the day and the time. So they knew that on October 11th at around 12 noon, there's going to be an eclipse. This is not new knowledge. Do you see what I'm saying? It's really important because there's an argument that, we've gone so far and the ancients didn't know any of this stuff and it's just not true. So the Muslims who improved upon Greek astronomy developed sighting charts. They knew when the moon was going to appear. They had 12 degree. They could determine with high accuracy. In Fez, I went to the astronomer's tower in Fez because a friend of mine inherited that position, the astronomer of Fez. He's a muwaqqit. And there's 12 little holes. Did you see them? Yeah. There's 12 little holes. And all year long, they know exactly where to look. And they know exactly where the hilal is going to be. Right? Because nothing changes. It's exact. So this stuff is not new stuff. And the ulama talked about predicting centuries ago because they had astronomers that could predict when the new moon was going to be most probably appear. They all knew when the mufaraqa happened. But no one in the history of Islam, with the exception of the Fatimiyya, ever said that the Mufaraqa was the new moon. Because if you make the Mufaraqa the new moon, you're going to destroy the lunar calendar of Islam. Because you're going to always have these problematic... you're giving too much time, so the days you're going to have... the months are going to go... just like what happened in Arabia, because they do this, they'll get one day ahead of themselves. They've gotten 2 days ahead of themselves, where the new moon's not supposed to come out for like at least 2 days, and the new moon appears. Or the opposite happens. They declare a new moon and nobody sees the hilal for 3 days. Because if you should see it immediately, it's only going to have a lag time of 1 day. It'll never have a lag time of 2 days on a month. So if you have 30 days of Sha'ban, you'll see it on that 31st day. You're either going to see it on the 30th or the 31st, but you're not going to see it on the 32nd day. But because of these problems of determining the new moon with these calculations, you can be 2 days off. Because they're determining it within this period of time. And this is where the problem happens, all right? Mm-hmm. Astronomy? It's a good science.
Yeah. Astronomy, horoscopes,
all. Oh, that's astrology. Yeah. Astronomy is different from astrology. So, do you read your horoscope?
No, I don't.
I was wondering. I look at mine every once in a while. You know, it's kind of a curious thing.
Yeah?
Yeah. And then you say, SubhanAllah. Yeah, that's why they put them in the newspapers, right. You know, yeah, because people are interested.
But we shouldn't just, like...
A predictive astrology is haram.
Like if it's in the newspaper.
Yeah, predictive astrology is haram, mm-hmm. by consensus. You can't... Ibn Ataillah says, even if it was accurate, you can't spy on God.
Mm-hmm. But even looking at it...
Yeah, because Allah says, لَا تَجَسَّسُ. You know, so even if it was accurate, you can't spy on God. The majority of ulama rejected astrology. Some of the ulama had tawakkuf. They just said, leave it. There's no doubt that there's validity to astrology to a certain degree. Some of it is accurate. We know that there were signs in the heavens with the birth of Jesus, the birth of the Prophet ﷺ. You know, the heavens have signs for us. There's no doubt. And Allah made them signs. We know where all the constellations were the day he was born. Sa'ad al-Sa'ud was on the horizon. Sa'ad al-Dabih was overhead. It's all Sa'ada. All the stars of Sa'ada were in the positions of the stars when he was born. You know, the joyous stars. They were all there. We know he was born in the sun sign of Aries. You know, which is the sign of leadership in that system. So there's all those things are there, but... You know, to go, and that's why the Muslims, you know, the Muslims used astrology. I mean, some of our rulers, just like today, don't think these guys are free of this. They have astrologers. I know personally the one of the astrologers of several of people in the House of Lords. She became Muslim, and she was the personal astrologer of several of the people in the House of Lords. Ronald Reagan had an astrologer. We know that. We don't know if Obama's using one or the, you know, there's Muslim rulers now. And I guarantee you, because I know this for a fact, there are Muslim rulers that use astrologers. So astrology is around. It's been around for centuries and there's people that, you know, and it's a very, you know, if you get Chinese astrology is more interesting to me than Western astrology. But if you get into astrology, it is a science. There's no doubt. It's a science. And to deny it and say, oh, and laugh at it and say it's a big joke and things like that, those things don't stay around for millennia if there's not some basis. Do you know what I mean? Every astrologer is an astronomer. You have to be. You see, every astrologer has to learn. So when the ulama, I mean, all these engineers made fun of, they said, oh, Muslims, you know, the reason they prohibited this is because it was all associated with astrology. You know, and they kind of made fun of it and, you know, oh, the Munajimun. No, the Munajimun all learned astronomy because they have to determine the positions of the stars. But predictive astrology is haram. It's haram. you know, personality astrology, Allahu A'lam, you know, Allahu A'lam. There's good arguments against it. You know, I've read some of the arguments against it. They make a lot of sense. You know, for instance, the sun signs today are not actually in the original times because of the precession, and, you know, there's changes. So if you were born in March today, it's, or April, it's not really Aries because there's been a lag time now. So, you know, there's very valid arguments against it. Fakhruddin al-Razi, Imam al-Ghazali, they had just tawakkuf. You know, just leave it. It's not something to delve into. And that's I agree with that. Just leave it. It's something Muslims shouldn't get into.
But if you look at it, like, you do.
I don't look at it. I mean, I'm just, you know, yeah. I mean, every once in a while. But it's more funny because those things are just, I don't believe in any of that stuff. The newspaper ones, yeah, that's just entertainment.
Okay.
Yeah, people take it seriously.
Yeah, but for entertainment.
I wouldn't take, it's just entertainment. You know, I wouldn't take it seriously. Yeah. I mean, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said one of the things that he feared was, he said, أَخْوَفُ مَا أَخَافُ عَلَيْكُمْ الْإِسْتِسْقَاءُ بِالْأَنْوَاءِ, is that you start associating rain with stars. Because the note are the stars that are on the horizons, and those are the stars that astrologers use to determine, you know, certain things about astrology. And so when certain stars show up, the rain seasons come. So the Prophet was saying what he was afraid of is people associating those things with the rain. In the same way, astrology, if you think that the reason you're like this is because you were born in the sun sign of this, that becomes shirk. Absolutely. Yeah, no, it's shirk. And you can fall into shirk because even if it was true, there's no correlation other than that God determined you would be like this when this was there. It's God that does it. It has nothing to do with the stars. There's no celestial influence. People say, oh, don't you see how the moon is influencing the tides? No, that's just your observation that every time the moon's full, the tides are that way. When it's not full, they're that way. God's doing that. He just set it up so it looks like that. So if you make the mistake of assuming it's the moon that's doing that, that's your problem. But it's shirk because you're giving power to asbab, the sabab. You know, dhuhr is an obligation to pray. The sabab for dhuhr is when that happened. But that's not what's making it obligatory. God is making it obligatory. He's just saying do it at that point. So, but if you think it's, that's why it's obligatory. That's shirk.
Yeah, but it's not just the fact that the moon is, it's like it's the gravity of the moon that's
pulling. No, that's all. No. It's not gravity. No. That's all. That's, look. That is all people describing things. Like the law of gravity is just descriptions. All that is, that's what it appears.
You can't say that Allah is causing the law of
gravity? No. Allah's doing it all directly in our aqidah. Weren't you there the other night? Allah's doing everything. These are just things. Look, you know, this is Hume. Hume used to play billiards. David Hume, the philosopher. And he would notice when he hit the ball and the ball would hit the other ball, it would knock it into the pocket. But he started thinking about that. I think he was reading Muslim books. Because he gives exact examples of what the Muslims did. Allahu A'lam. But he could have come up. He was a genius. But what he said he realized was, I'm only assuming that that ball is knocking the other ball into it. So you can explain that with physics, right? Of how that's a mass, you know, and a body's at rest unless it's acted upon by a body in motion, right? That's physics, right? But what he said is, we're just making that assumption from observation. The reality of it is, we really don't know what's happening. These are just our attempts at explaining things. But we really don't know what's going on. Do you see? That's the Muslim position. That Allah made it when see, look, if I take a knife, like a surgeon's knife, and you know, and I cut, right? I cut open. What you're observing is when the blade touches the skin, it opens the skin, right? And so you say the blade is cutting. We don't believe that. What we believe is that when at the point the blade meets the skin, God is opening that. It's a direct action of God. It only appears that the knife is doing that. That's Tawheed. But the way that it appears to us is how we're explaining it. But the Arifin don't see that. That's why when he was choking Mu'adh, from a doctor would say he was choking because he had swelling in his throat. And the swelling was caused. He wasn't seeing that. He was saying, "Akhnuq khanaqak." You know, he was talking to God. Go ahead, choke me. Because he knew that it was God that was doing that, and not even doing it with secondary causation, which is Ibn Taymiyyah's position. That's Ibn Taymiyyah's position. That was rejected by the Sunnis, that there's secondary causation. That's a deistic perspective, you know, that there's secondary causes going on. That's not what's happening. There's no secondary causes. We don't believe in secondary causes. Every act is an act of God. Every act that's happening. There's no gravity, all that stuff. Those are just things that we use to explain phenomenon. But in reality, it's God that's doing that. He's holding it all into place. He's al-qayyum. لَا تَأْخُذُهُ سِنَةٌ وَلَا نَوْمٌ. He can't for one instant turn away from creation, or else it all stops. Because he's the one doing it all. But he's set up a creation of appearances. You have appearances and reality. Like in literature, you study literature. That's a theme, right, in literature. Appearances and reality, right? Iago is a good friend. Good Iago. That's what Othello calls him when he sees him. Good Iago. You know, that's the appearance of Iago. The reality of Iago is that he was evil and he had malintentions towards Othello. That's the way the Allah has set up the world. There's appearances and zuyyina, you know, زُيِّنَ لَهُمْ أَعْمَلُ. Their actions appear to be good. The people that are sowing corruption in the earth, they think they're... If you talk to them, we're bringing democracy to the Middle East. We're helping people get... You know, no, they're opening up markets so they can flood people with facade. And, you know, they want to bring pornography to Pakistan and to... That's what they're doing, because there's money to be made. But they'll tell you, the pornographers in Hollywood will tell you, this is about freedom of speech. This is First Amendment. That's what they believe. That's exactly what Allah says about them. They believe that their actions are good. We're helping people get liberated. They've got all these hang-ups. You know, I mean, this is the world. The world is appearances. It's not reality. Bernie Madoff was the head of dozens of philanthropic organizations. He was honored with plaques. Appearances and reality. All of that. So anyway, that's an aqidah lesson and we're in fiqh. Uzma did that just to wake me up. So, where were we? Citing astrology. That's how, see, somebody asked a question about astrology. So that's the thing. Astrology, don't waste your time. But I've got handwritten manuscripts in my library of astrology from ulama. There used to be ulama that practiced that. Some of the timekeepers, and these were real ulama. You know, they used to do it on the side to make money. You know, with the notables in the societies. Even in Abu Tamam's poem about Mu'tasim, he checked with the astrologers about whether or not it was an auspicious time to attack the Christians, and they said no, it was a bad time, and he said the hell with it. And so Abu Tamam praises him because he defeated them. So he said, in spite of the astrologers, you know, he went to fight the jihad and Allah gave him victory, you know. But the astrologer said, no, don't do it. Like Ronald Reagan, they were telling him, no, don't, it's not a good time to meet with the Russians. Inauspicious, Jupiter's in Saturn rising, and anyway, so this point now, when it comes out of here, is when you see the crescent. What that crescent is the moon's light at that point. As each day, you're getting more light, right? Because of the angle, until you get here. Now you're seeing a quarter of it, right? When you're here, seeing half. And then even more. Each night, you're getting more. And then you get the full moon. And now it starts to diminish, right? It goes the other way. So you start seeing it diminishing until it gets down. Now you're at that where you get slight, it looks like a crescent in the morning, and then it moves in to the conjunction, and it disappears completely for 2 days. And then it'll reemerge. Now what we don't know is when it's gonna reemerge. So what happens is there are several factors. There's a humidity factor. There's an angular factor, where you are on the planet. If you're in a desert climate, if you're in an equatorial country, if you look at the those things where it shows you the, like, all the red where you're going to see the moon, but down here in Mexico you can't see it. Because what happens is every month, the moon on the horizon, every month, right? This is the Mashriq, and this is the Maghrib, right? Every month, the moon is doing what the sun does in a year. It's going from north to south, right? So as you're watching it across the thing, that's why you'll see the moon move on the horizon if you watch it. You know, people don't watch this stuff anymore. They just see the moon come up. They don't think about where it's coming up. But if you watch it on the horizon, you know, as it's moving from, this is actually north and south. You know, this is Shamal and Junub. So as it's moving across, and then you're looking at either this is east or west, depending on whether, you know, which direction you're looking at. So when it's small, it's on the east side. As it's moving to the north, right, and then it goes to the east. Yeah. So it goes from west when it's small, and then it's moving like that, and then it goes, now it's due east, right, when it's full, and then it's moving that way. But if you watch it along these two horizons, it's moving like that. So it's going to show up down in the south, or it's going to show up in the north. If it shows up in the north, people in the south won't be able to see it if they're too far south. If it shows up in the south, that's why sometimes we can see it in South America, we can't see it in North America. Sometimes they can see it in South Africa, they can't see it in Europe. Sometimes they can see it in Europe, they can't see it in South Africa, right? So this creates a problem for sighting. Now the other problem is as the moon is moving across the globe, if say the mufaraqa occurs here, we're in China, okay? So the mufaraqa, right, which is when it's lined up with the sun, all right? It occurs here. So now the crescent, after several hours here, say it's 24 hours after the mufaraqa. So that's the first day. So it took one day, it went in, now it's coming out, and you see it 20 hours. So it's still within that first day. It's going to be a very fine sliver. All right? So now people here in China, you know, they're all jumping up. Chinese Muslims, Allahu Akbar, Takbir. They see it. Now, anybody who sees it in China and they tell us, we're in California, and they say they saw it in China, we are definitely going to see it in California. It's impossible not to see it unless it's cloudy all across the coast. We're going to see it. So when Saudi Arabia says they see the moon and we go out in America, 15 hours later. So they saw it when the moon was 15 hours. Now it's 30 hours old. We have to see it. So when we go out and we don't see the moon anywhere, what do we know? Maybe they're not lying. You know, I mean, I'm not going to assume they're lying. Because Shureyh al-Qadi, went out with somebody and they were all looking for the moon, and the man said, Allahu Akbar, you know, the moon. And they're all like, where? He said, right there. They're where? Right there, Allahu Akbar. That little sliver. So Shuraih's looking, you know, he said, and he looks at the man and he notices he has a thin hair from his eye, from the eyebrow going down. So Shuraih wipes it and he says, do you still see it? And he said, SubhanAllah, it disappeared. So, you know, people can think they see the new moon, but they don't see it, right? We've seen the moon several times, right? Very tiny. You usually see it first. Very tiny little moon. So if you see the moon, it's a joyous occasion. But people think they see the moon, especially if they're not trained to see the moon. There's people, they see an airplane, because the airplane will shine the light of the sun. And you'll see so the wing of the airplane slightly tipped, you know, and they, oh, there it is. Oh, it disappeared, you know. And then they go and they call, Allahu Akbar, we saw the moon, and it was United Airlines flight 707. No, seriously. So people think they see the moon. They don't see the moon. Now, if, as it's moving across, so they saw it here at 21 hours. So by the time it gets to America, whatever the, it could be like 36 hours. Now, what's going to happen is that when we see it, because now it's 36 hours old from when it was first the Mufaraqa, it's going to be much bigger. It's going to be higher in the sky, because if here's the thing, the next day it's 13 degrees higher. So each day it's increasing by 13 degrees, and you're seeing more of it because of the angle. So people will, they'll miss it here because of clouds. The next day they'll see it, which is actually the first day for them. But what will they say? That's 2 days old. Because they don't understand this. The Prophet ﷺ said that the end of time won't come until people will look at a new moon and say it's 2 days old. Because they don't know this anymore. It's not a problem. It shouldn't be 3 days. That is a problem. And the reason it's 3 days is because people either lie or they did not see the moon and they claim to have seen the moon. They thought they saw the moon. And that's where we get 3 day differences. But normally you should only have 2 day differences. Well, no, people go out and look. But like Sheikh Abdullah went out with a group of Saudis once and they were all looking to the east. And Sheikh Abdullah said, no, it's over here. It's to the west. Oh, mashallah, Sheikh, jazakallah khairan. You know, thank God we have ulama.
Sorry, Sheikh, we always have the same problem
every year.
Every
yeah.
year. Because we're in Oman, and Oman always celebrates one day later than Saudi Arabia. Because
they're right. They're following the right criterion.
Oman
is right, I guarantee you. Oman and Morocco, Morocco is probably the safest of all the countries in the Arab world, in my estimation. Do you know?
Mm-hmm. If they see it, and you say that you guarantee you'll see it in California, what are countries that have people on the East Coast? Like, who's sighting? How far out of sighting can we use? Somebody in China claims that they see the moon.
Yeah, no, that's a good point. Well, first of all, they're past the international date line. So they're already, and we've missed it. We were looking for it. We didn't see it. They saw it. By the time it gets back to us, another day's. So we're actually going to fast the next day anyway. We're not going to fast the same day they fasted. Mm-hmm.
With all the different calculations, you're saying that there's these increasing lag times. It seems like if people are traveling around a lot, there's a possibility that they might end up fasting 28 days.
And that does happen. And the Prophet, that was already happened at the time of the Prophet. And people should break the fast on the Eid day if the moon was sighted, and then they owe a day.
Okay.
Yeah, but it's a good question, because it does happen, and that did happen at the time of the Sahaba. Somebody only fasted 28 days. If the moon was sighted, if it wasn't sighted, if they're doing 30 days, you still fast. So you don't break the fast. Unless, It just depends on, you know, because it's haram to fast on the Eid day. And if it's your community and you fasted in another place, I would break the fast and then make up the day.
What about if you go to 31?
It's haram. You can't fast 31 days.
So what do you do?
What's that?
You said you can't fast 31 days, but because of traveling, you end up 31 days, you just not fast the following day if it happens?
Oh, no. You should assume, if that's the case, that you started a day early. And then you just, that's a nafila fast. You can't fast, meaning you can't fast on Eid. So if the Eid hasn't occurred where you are, you wait till the Eid comes.
Okay.
Yeah, and then you just had an extra day. Mm-hmm.
So they have a problem in London because the different mosques follow different days.
Yeah.
Starting
out. Mm-hmm. This is a problem. If you don't have a caliph or an imam or a sultan, like in Oman they have sultan, Qaboos. He says it's Ramadan, everybody fasts Ramadan. That's the way it works. And there's a benefit to that, you know, to have a unified, because even in Saudi, they have to go with the government. You know, if the government says it's Ramadan, it's Ramadan. Even the Prophet ﷺ said, you know, عيدكم يوم تضحون, your Eid is the day that you sacrifice, meaning that if you made a mistake, it doesn't matter, it's still Eid. So even if the government makes a mistake, it's not on the people, it's on the government. If they did it by using incorrect criteria. I mean, I've been working with a group of people trying to get, you know, but our community is just so dysfunctional, you know. We've been trying to get together a thing to take to the highest levels in Saudi, you know, because the problem is they have ulama that don't understand this stuff, literally. They think it's astrology. You know, they think astronomy and astrology, and they're kind of, you know, this is the problem. So their ulama, you know, don't follow the opinion of what's called nafi. You know, the al-ilm yanfi wa la yuthbit in this mas'ala. Imam al-Qarafi said, astronomers can negate the sighting, but they cannot calculate it. So if astronomers say it's impossible for the moon to be seen on that day, and people come and they say they saw it, we say, you didn't see it, you saw something else. Because the moon, you can't see it if it's... The world record is 15 hours. The world record is 15 hours, naked eye sighting. That's the world record. There's a project that the Greenwich is doing now, which is they're trying to determine when they're studying it and they're using Muslims to do it because they've gotten interested in this problem from us. NASA has a section on their website for Muslims because they are interested in it. They didn't used to be interested in it, but now they realize it's an interesting topic. And I recorded this in that Caesarean Moonburst. NASA, which is the highest, I mean, that's it. That's the pinnacle of astronomy. And I mean, the English might say Greenwich is, but, you know, NASA is, you know, that's it. They have the biggest budgets, everything. They say on their website, you cannot predict the visibility of the moon. You can only predict the probability of its visibility. You cannot predict its visibility. And what ISNA is telling us is, I mean, astaghfirullah, you know, I don't want, but I mean, everybody, this is, you know, in here, ISNA took that position and other people have taken it, and certain countries are arguing for it now. There's ulama that are arguing to abandon naked eye sighting because they say, look, we've got anarchy all over. The problem is not the anarchy. It's the problem is nobody cares about Islam anymore. That's the problem. If we had international conferences and brought people together and had intelligent people explain this, this stuff could all be resolved very easily. But we're dysfunctional. The religion's in an incredibly inept state. You know, and our ulama are inept, our organizations are inept, our conferences are inept. I mean, you do a conference here and it's all planned, it all runs on time, they all deliver their papers, the papers are published. You go to a Muslim conference and, you know, the guys are shuffling their papers around because, you know, they just printed it off the computer, right? You know? I mean, I've been to the highest levels of Muslim conferences in the world. And I've seen the highest functioning people that we have in the Ummah, and we're a mess. You know, so I'm waiting. Young people need to wake up and realize there's other ways that this can be done. There's reasons for the dysfunctionalities, you know, there are moribund societies, and they don't give religion its due anymore. And the governments don't really want to, religion's a control mechanism. You know, Ramadan's not really, they don't care. What's the problem? What's the problem? You know, just fast on Tuesday, why not? Right? Seriously. That's the way they look at it. Whereas people that take their religion seriously, it's no, I want to fast when God told me to fast. It's like Sheikh Khatri said, why are these people so hasty to fast? Because if you delay your fast for certainty, you get a reward. But if you hasten your fast without certainty, you're doing something haram. So why is everybody in such a hurry? Well, the reason they're in a hurry here is because we live in a highly structured society that demands dates. And so if you want your day off from the job and the boss says, well, which day would you like, Abdul? Well, it's either going to be Tuesday or Thursday. You know, Abdul, you got to make up your mind because... I can't make up my mind. Well, why not? Because it depends on the moon sighting. Depends on the moon sighting. So we'll cancel that conference that we had planned on Tuesday or Wednesday, depending on whether you sight the moon. Do you see what I mean? So that's the problem. Or we want our kids to have holidays, like in New York. They just voted. The whole city council voted to give the Muslims their Eid. So now the city council's planning their little... Right? Their little calendar for the the coming year. Okay, Ghulam, so when's the, what day is it going to be? Well, it's either going to be on the 13th or the 14th. You know, it doesn't work for the New York City School Council. They're not going to have a little question mark on their calendar. You know, this is the day all the Muslim kids get off. Well, that doesn't work like that either, because a day is a lot of time. Yeah, but that's true. They give 2 days. Yeah, but they're not going to do that. So this is the problem. People want, you know, that's why I called it cesarean moon bursts. You know, cesarean bursts, the doctor can calendar in the date when you give birth, right? So, I mean, trust me, these obstetricians, you know, they love cesarean bursts because they can get their golf in on Thursday because they know they're going to be free between, right? But if you know, April doesn't know when her water's going to break, you know, it's hard to schedule in that golf game, right? Or you're playing on the eighth hole and the phone rings and April's water's burst and he has to leave his game. So they love... C-sections. That's why there's been studies done that there are far more C-sections done in this culture than are necessary. Why? Because they make a lot more money too. You have the operating theater, you have operation. This is true. Don't think all these doctors are selfless. You know, they got to pay their yacht bills and right? Their private airplanes. I mean, I have a doctor, he's got a private airplane. I was like, you know, I'm worried now about, like, so what's that $1,500 there for? You know, right? Seriously, because those guys, you know, it's just humans. Mm-hmm. What's that? Oh, okay, good. Yeah, Ittihad al-Mutali'. The Hanafi position is any sighting anywhere in the world is valid for everywhere in the world. And that is an interesting position, and I'll tell you why. Generally, the full moon will be unified around the world. The night the moon's full, it's going to be unified. So there is an argument for that. You know, I think, Abu Hanifa's position. The Maliki said, if the distance becomes greater than Andalusia, which is now Spain, and Khorasan, which is Central Asia, then if the sighting is, so if they saw it in Spain, it doesn't apply for Central Asia. However, if they saw it in Central Asia, they're definitely going to see it in Spain. All right, so the West is not a hujjah is a hujjah over the East, but the East is not a hujjah over the West. That's the qa'idah. So if they see it in Sudan, you know, and you call grandma and she says, you know, Ramadan Mubarak, we saw the moon. And you say, you really saw it? Now you know grandma doesn't lie, so you don't need two witnesses, right? But by the time the moon gets to where you are in Champaign, Illinois, you, if it's a clear day, you have to see it. There's no way she could have seen it, and it won't be seen here. So if you don't see it, and it was a clear day, and nobody saw it, grandma might have had one of those hairs on her, But Muslims want to fast with back home. There's a lot of immigrants here. They want to break their fast with their, so they can call on the Eid. You know, it's not very much fun when, you know, your uncle calls from Damascus, Eidikum Mubarak, kul am wantum bi khair. We're still fasting. You know, tomorrow is our Eid. Ish hadha. You know, min hun lil hun mashi. You know, what's going on? Right? We saw it. You know, and then you get into the whole. So there's so many things that people aren't ulama, right? And there's all these emotional things and people, you know. Mm-hmm. That's what I mean. It's not a hujjah. We're the hujjah against them. Because if they say they saw it and we don't see it, we're a hujjah against them that they didn't see it. Whereas if we see it, right, we're not a hujjah for them because they didn't necessarily see it because it's born much later in the West. So they can say, well, they saw it in California, but that doesn't apply to us because we're in Morocco. And there wasn't enough, you know, the moon wasn't old enough because it gets 8 hours by the time it gets to California, or 10.
So why don't they just wait until the West sees it?
That's my argument. Let the Californians decide. No, because, you know, it's there's definitely, California is a strong for when it's visible in California as a first sighting. There, it's a strong position. But it could be we missed it, you know, and it could have been seen in an earlier place and we didn't see it, depending on if it was in the south. The real problem that I have, and I haven't worked this out, is the cutoff of Mexico, you know, is really kind of a racist thing. Like, why do we say North American sighting? So if I'm in Houston and I don't see the moon, but in Tijuana they see it, or in Juarez they see it, why don't we take that sighting? That to me is a problem. South America, because we're on the same longitude, right? So the latitude is going to, you know, if the latitude is different, you can really not see it on the entire latitude. But the longitude, you can see it in South America and not see it. But it's the same. Because you're on the same longitude, it really is your moon. Do you see what I mean? So we expect the Canadians to fast with us here in North America, right? Because we saw it in California, even though they can't see it in Canada. But we don't use the same criterion with South American. You see what I'm saying? So it's a problem. These things need to be resolved at the level of conferences and debate and argumentation until we can clear this thing out. But Muslims are the most, you know, people tell me, I don't like organized religions. I say, Islam's a religion for you. We are the most unorganized religion on the planet, you know.
Mm-hmm. And we didn't see it on the East Coast. Should we have seen it?
No, we could have seen it if it's a sliver, you know, because there's a lag time of 3 hours, which is considerable, right? You know, because the angular separation, okay, here's the horizon. Say the mufaraqa occurred here, like your horizon is here, because the earth is round. So the mufaraqa occurs here. The moon starts moving away from the sun at this point, right? as it's moving, and it's on an angular, right, like this, because it's rising like this, okay? So, in Saudi Arabia, when Maghrib comes, it's right there, all right? There's the crescent. But because it's so low on the horizon, the angular separation isn't 12 degrees, because 12 degrees is when it becomes visible. So let's say it's at 6 degrees here, all right? They're not going to see it. You cannot see it. You could see it with a telescope. But once you open up the telescope, then you have to go to the mufaraqa, because the telescope can see the mufaraqa. That's the problem with telescopes. Because we've seen it. You can see it with the binoculars. But it's, if you go without a naked eye sighting, then you've entered into a slippery slope, and you're going to have a real problem. That's why it's better to leave it at naked eye sighting. Why do you think the Prophet ﷺ never went out to sight the new moon? There's no hadith that the Prophet went out to sight the new moon. What's that? He had telescopic sight. He saw 12 stars in Pleiades. There's only 7. If you get a modern astronomy book and look at a picture of Pleiades with the Hubble telescope or one of the major telescopes they use, there are 12 big stars in the constellation of Pleiades. I counted them myself. You can open up any book. There are 12, that's a clear miracle of the Prophet ﷺ. He saw 12 stars in Pleiades because he could see much further than, just like he could see behind his head, he could see much further than normal humans. So he didn't go out because he would have seen the moon right when it appeared. There it is, nobody else could see it. What's that? The Sahaba went out and they spotted it. He didn't go out. Isn't that amazing? Alhamdulillah. So now Saudi didn't see it, even though they claim to. All right, so this, it's only here, it's only been a few hours. Okay, so say it was 6 hours here. Now, down the road, in Morocco, it's now you're at 12 degrees. So the Moroccans go out and they see with somebody sees it with a binoculars, but nobody sees it with naked eyes. So Morocco says it's not Ramadan. Now we're down in the US and it's 20 hours. People go out. This is still low on the horizon, by the way. 20 hours. It's not high. And it's not going to be much of a crescent, right? But people go out, and people in New York don't see it. 23 hours later, people go out in... So now we're 23 hours. They go out, and they see it in California, right? So they know Ramadan's tomorrow. Now, technically, we could call Saudi Arabia, but Saudi Arabia's already past Fajr. So that day, you know, unless the ulama, you know, you're not supposed to fast on the day of Shak, which is another proof to me that the Prophet ﷺ did not intend us to calculate it, because he said, "Man sama yom ash-shak faqad asa Abu al-Qasim." If you fast on the day of doubt, then you've disobeyed the Prophet. What is the day of doubt? It's the 30th day after the new moon of Sha'ban. Because if you went out on the 30th night and you didn't see it, so you completed 29 days of Sha'ban, sunset comes, you go out, this is the 30th day of Sha'ban, you don't see the moon, it could be Ramadan. It could be. But it's doubt. It's a doubt. It's shak. You don't know. It either is or it isn't. So the Prophet said, do not fast the day of doubt. Ibn Umar fasted the day of doubt if it was cloudy. So what he understood the hadith to mean, if you went out on a clear day and didn't see it, but if it was cloudy, he fasted as a precaution because you could end up fasting the next month, right? If you had 30 days of the previous month and you were off, which is possible. So now you're actually 2 days, you could end up being, but the beauty of the lunar calendar is it's a self-correcting calendar. It can never, if you follow it properly, it will never be more than a day off. But when you start finagling it with calculations, you can get up to 3 days off. That's the difference. Because the average month is 29.5 days. But that average is an average. The reality is some are 29.2, some are 29.9. You see what I mean? So the average is 29.5. And that's why we have either 30 or 29 days. And it'll work equally, it's equally distributed throughout the year. So you're going to have 6 months. That's why the Arabs in Jahiliyyah used to have 29-30. That's the way they did it, irrespective of the, just made things easier. The Jews do what's intercalation, which the Prophet said was a type of kufr, which is where you add days and subtract days. So every 4 years, the Jews add 10 days to their calendar so that they can calculate.
Mm-hmm. So if I'm in Saudi and I don't see the moon, and then a few hours later, the moon is not sighted in Spain, and it's right before Fajr, but the Saudi government, let's say, says they see the moon, but in Spain they say they don't see the moon,
mm-hmm.
So almost Fajr, Nova Scotia hasn't seen the moon. Is it safer for me not to fast because...
You know, it depends. I mean, these are ijtihadat. Technically, you can fast with Saudi. It's a valid, I wouldn't do it. They had 2 first days of Muharram this year. Everybody got newspapers on the first of Muharram. It said first of Muharram. They read it. The next day, it said first of Muharram. And they didn't say anything to anybody. Look. We could solve this very easily, even in the United States. I guarantee you, we can predict when the moon is going to be sighted. We can do it. And we can have naked eye sighting. Because we've been doing this for how many years? Like 15 years? Every month, Yusuf Ismail and a group of people go out every month. He takes pictures of the new moon. He's got a record of the new moon for the last 15 years. He knows exactly where they're going to be. He knows how accurate these things, 12 degrees angular separation. If it's a clear day, we're going to see it. And fortunately for America, we have clear days somewhere. It doesn't matter if it's winter, summer, spring, or fall. Our continent is big enough. Somebody in Florida, Texas, and California is going to see the new moon. Somebody. It's just that's the way we have. So we can actually have a unified sighting in this country if we all got on board with the same basic criteria. But the problem is, ISNA's using a 9-degree angular separation. That's their degree. That is optimal, perfect conditions, record sighting. It's not going to happen. So you're not going to get ISNA's calculation and a sighting in the same, they're always going to be a day ahead of the naked eye sighters. And that's why I asked Khalid Chokat, who I like, I think he's a good guy, just give us 3 degrees. 3 degrees, that's all we're asking. You know what that is? It's 12 minutes. Just 3 degrees. Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly.
Does that point change?
It changes throughout the year. Oh, yeah, changes. That's why you get these different sites. It's subhanAllah. I mean, I really feel like it's like God just, he did it. It's the wrench in the works. I'm not going to give you a schedule that you can, you can calendar in on because my religion's not a convenience religion. And then I want you to go out and look. I want you to look forward to this day. You know? I don't want you to, oh, yeah, when's Ramadan start? The 22nd of August. Oh, great, you know? And then, I mean, really, that's what everybody wants. But I actually get my kids out. We go up Mount Diablo. They're all excited. Whoever sees it first gets $20, you know? And it's a really neat, isn't it nice? Every year, it's amazing. And when we see it, and if we don't see it, mashallah, not Ramadan, we go back down. Then the next day we go out and it's, you can see it. And it's exciting and it's wonderful. And I think that's part of the, you know, of it's part, I mean, all you have to do is read Titus Burkhart's description of sighting the moon in Fez, in a book he wrote called Fez, the Sacred City of Islam. He said that in Ramadan, everybody in Fez got on their rooftops and they would go out. And he said that this is 1932, pre, you know, hardly any electricity. So, you know, he goes out and he says, suddenly you'd hear this, Allahu Akbar. And then, Allahu Akbar. Allah. And he said, before long, the entire city. You know, it's just community. That's that's what we've lost. This human, you know, we've lost human community. We've lost that, you know. And I experienced it. I experienced it in Mauritania, and you know, I experienced it in places in Morocco. And people don't realize what it is that's been lost. So you can do your calculations. You can factor in. You can go online and have your virtual community, and you know, you fast online and do all that stuff. But you know, I don't know how much what the Sahaba would recognize of you know, this religion, you know, what they would, you know. So, but it's a beautiful description. And if you've experienced it, you know exactly what I'm talking about. Just the joy. Because, you know, the reason they call it istihlal, you know, the birth of the new moon is, and it's the same word that's used for the birth of a baby, because there's a shout of joy. And that's literally what the dictionaries say. It's sarkhat al-farah. You know, it's a shout of joy on sighting the new moon. That's why they call it the istihlal. You know, it's bi istihillu. It's like, it's just such a beautiful thing. And it's pure emergence. You know, it's like Allah, I mean, if you've ever seen the birth, because you can sight it, but I've actually seen the birth where it just appears, and it's something amazing. I've only seen it twice, but if you see it, you'll know exactly what I mean. There's nothing like seeing the moon suddenly just come into existence. It's something just so glorious to see it literally just appear. So you're looking, you know exactly where to look, and suddenly it just appears. It's just amazing. Anyway, you know, people are going to do what they're going to do, but I'm going to try to keep this alive as long as I can. And, you know, people can do what they do and what they feel comfortable with doing. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, I think you have to be careful. I wouldn't go against a community, personally. Fortunately, we have enough people doing that, even though in our community they fast different days, like many communities in the U.S. But if it's just two or three people, I don't know. I think I'd rather be with the jama'ah, you know. There's certainly, you know, these opinions are validated by valid scholars. So I would not go by foreign sightings personally. But if people hear, you know, if they have a sighting here. And so I don't know. I mean, you know, it's better to try to convince the community, you know. And the nice thing about the Pakistani community is that you've got these kind of, you know, Deobandis that, you know, that, John Mubarak, yeah, Blessed New Moon. So, but you have these Deobandis that don't, they want to follow the Sunnah. And, you know, we're trying to unify them, but like I said, we've got so much dysfunctionality in our community, it's really hard. If the Naked Eye community would get together and really, you know, what we need to develop is committees around the U.S. that are certified, you know, so that we're all, you know, within an hour or two, we're going to know. So people aren't waiting till 1 a.m. and, because it is inconvenient for a lot of people, and you have to make it convenient to the best of the ability. But, you know, I think there's a lot that could be done, personally. It needs effort. And, you know, it's one of those things like, it's exhausting to try to do, you know, there's not enough Muslims doing stuff that they should be doing. There should be people working full time on this. I mean, you know, You know, you have to send out people because you get openings in clouds and things like that. So you should always go out and look, even if it's overcast. Yeah. Yeah, no, and there's some people do that. I mean, it should not be a divisive thing. That's the key thing. It shouldn't be like, we're right and you're wrong. No, it's a khilaf. We don't have a hakim, and people have to follow their conscience. In the end of the day, you know, Islam is about, I mean, I know Mauritanian sheikh, my sheikh, Hamad Amir al-Wali, didn't used to fast in the Emirates, with the Emirates. Because he'd go out, he didn't see the moon, and he grew up in the desert, he knows how to sight the moon, and he just wouldn't fast with them on Ramadan. So that was and he was the only guy, but he didn't make any announcements, and, you know, they're all wrong and I'm right. It was just his personal following what he believed. Marabt al-Hajj doesn't listen to the radio in Nouakchott. If the Nouakchott announces that they're, he said they don't have Shahada in anything else, why should I give him Shahada in Ramadan? You know, I mean, they're not trustworthy in anything else, right? So why should I give them, you know? On the other hand, Sheikh Abdullah bin Bayya is adamant about following, you know, like he follows Saudi Arabia because they're ulil amri and it's on them. And he sees it as potentially, you know, it becomes like khawarij. You know, you're going out against your rulers. And that's his approach, which I think is probably a more far-sighted approach. I mean, Mauritania is nice in that there's no real central government in the way you have it in other places, because the Bedouin are pretty much autonomous anyway. Yeah, I would do that. I would do that. I would go out to the Eid, you know, and pray with the community, and I think lunch is ready. Barakallahu fikum.